Thank you, Nancy. Hello, I'm Rob Bexon.
And I'm Chris Willis, and we're here to talk to you about engaging and motivating teenagers towards exam success. At the end of the webinar, there will be time to answer some of your questions, so please use the chat box to write questions as you think of them during the webinar. We'll try to answer as many as possible in the time we have available. Before we begin, and to warm everyone up to the topic, we're going to ask you to take a quick look at a few typical comments we come across from the many teachers worldwide who are preparing teenagers for English exams. Perhaps you agree with some of these comments, perhaps you don't, but we thought it would be an interesting way to start this session and to get your ideas and some of your thoughts on this. So here are the five comments. First, let us know which one you strongly agree with by voting in the poll. Agree first, and then we'll look at which ones you disagree with afterwards. So use your polling buttons to tell us which one you agree with first. So here are the comments. A, all of my classes are very motivated and look forward to each lesson. B, I always make sure to include an equal share of reading, writing, listening and speaking in every class. C, my classes are mixed. Some of my students are preparing for Cambridge English exams, some are simply learning English. D, I'm not sure if my students are being exposed to useful and relevant English words and phrases that will be helpful in real situations. And E, we don't have time to focus on general English development. We have to use all the time available to prepare for the exam. Okay, let's see what we have as a nice warm-up exercise. What's coming up, Rob?
Okay, so C is proving the most popular, shall we say. My classes are mixed. Some of my students are preparing for Cambridge English exams. Some are simply learning English. So the correct people at the end of the camera then.
Okay, and just only 6% for motivated students, so hopefully we can help on that. So now this time, show us the ones you strongly disagree with. This time, just use the chat box to write the letter of the one you disagree with. Now remember, obviously, this is purely subjective. There are no right or wrong answers here. So remember, just put the one you strongly disagree with now in the chat box and we can have a look at what you think. Yeah, this is really, really interesting for us to have a look at. Mm-hmm. So what do you think then, Rob, what's coming through here?
A lot of A's coming through.
Yeah.
Coming through rather quite quickly.
There's a lot of people out there, yes. Okay, we're going to come back to these comments in a moment. So, I mean, these comments are really the starting point for everything we want to talk about today. We want to look at how we can best get the right balance in teen classes and how we can integrate exam practice into lessons in a relevant and enjoyable way. So here's an outline of what we're going to do in this session. In a moment, we'll continue with examining the various concerns we may have when we are teaching, and then we'll look in a bit more detail at the needs of the majority of teenagers that you may be preparing for the Cambridge English exams, or teenagers that are simply learning English generally, or I guess somewhere in the middle. Next, we'll look at an example of a Cambridge English exam task type and show how we might construct a sequence of lesson stages around this, integrating skills, language, practice, and of course, obviously, for this, exam preparation. We'll be using examples from our Cambridge English for Schools Prepare series to illustrate this. We'll then look at how research underpins everything we publish. And finally, we'll wrap up with some of the feedback we've gathered from teachers. So, Rob.
So, if we begin with an issue of balance, it's useful to think about your classes in the following way. I like to imagine a scale and think about how much of one side or another is most suitable for my class. And I encourage you to think for a moment about your classes. For example, one possible concern you may have is that the idea of have to versus want to in a typical class of teenagers learning English. How many are there because they want to learn English, and how many because they have to? You can let us know your thoughts in the chat box again. And your students, are your students there because they have to be or because they want to be? Okay, so are your students in the class because they have to be or because they want to be? And if you can put the answer in the chat box now.
There's a good one, you have to wins.
Have to. 70% have to.
And it's really coming through very strongly. Both. Some of both, yeah. Which is encouraging, I guess, but there's a lot of have-tos here. A lot of have-tos.
Heavily weighted, yeah.
I think so, yeah. It's difficult to say. Okay. 70-80%, I would say, is have-to.
Okay. It's often the case that some students are motivated to learn English, or any subject for that matter, and others are not initially engaged. In a way, this is what we are trying to do in our classes, move students more towards the want-to end of the spectrum. The second concern could apply to a class mixed with those taking Cambridge English exams and those not taking exams. Or it could apply to a purely exam preparation class. After all, the whole point of examining students in their English proficiency is to measure their progress and ability in the language, isn't it? Please write your thoughts on this in the chat box. How important is exam preparation compared to everyday English development in your situation? So, to repeat that question, how important is exam preparation compared to everyday English development in your situation? So, in the chat box now, please. What are we saying, Chris?
The first few coming through are both are important, but it seems to be a predominance now of exam preparation. Lots of equally importance, which I guess you would expect and we would hope to see. I've got people putting 80-20. I'm assuming 80-20, 80 in favour of preparation to 20% everyday English development.
That's the exam general debate, isn't it?
There's a couple in exclamation marks and capital letters as well. So
it depends, somebody just said. And yeah, I can imagine that's a very true of each situation is very different, very fluid.
Absolutely, it's incredibly flexible.
Yeah.
Interesting question. Okay.
Okay, so it could be argued that any exam preparation course should equally seek to contribute to students' overall English language development to some extent. However, sometimes we might feel that exam preparation is taking over and that the balance seems to be out of sync. Of course, there may be times, such as in the final stages of exam preparation, when we want or need our students to spend more time on exam preparation tasks. But this depends on your context. Thirdly, how much time is spent on the four traditional language skills in your classroom? Do you think the balance is right in your classes? Is the balance appropriate to the needs of your classes? Are you giving students the chance to really develop each skill, or is there a danger that they are simply testing themselves on each skill over and over again with little actual development and progress? Again, write your opinions in the chat box. I'll repeat the questions for you. So how much time is spent on the four skills, the four traditional language areas in your classroom? Do you think the balance is right for your classes? Is the balance appropriate for the needs of your class? Are you giving students the chance to really develop each skill, or is there a danger that they are simply testing themselves on each skill over and over again with little actual development and progress? So what are your opinions on that? What are we seeing, Chris?
Interesting. A lot of teachers here coming through are trying to achieve that balance, which is great. Others saying that, in particular, speaking seems to be losing out because of time available in the class, and maybe the size of the class as well, getting students to speak as much as possible. But again, a lot of information, a lot of opinions coming through about the importance of getting a balance.
Yeah, balance is focusing on the skills, isn't it?
Which is again, I think we'll be looking at as well in more detail. But definitely interesting about speaking, not having enough time.
Yeah, speaking is often a difficult one to do because of student reticence anyway.
Exactly, it depends on the class again, of course, absolutely. Yes, of course.
So, of course, this balance is something we can be aware of and try to adjust and tweak in each class. If we're faced with a reading practice task, for example, can we perhaps develop it as a speaking task afterwards? Or writing task, which follows on from a listening task, and so on. Students themselves may even decide that they need to improve on one skill and don't always realise the importance of keeping up to scratch with all skills as much as possible. And how about you? Do you feel you neglect any particular skill or skills too often in class? For me, I remember being petrified of teaching writing for a long time. It wasn't until I understood the support and advice I could provide to aid my students in writing that I became more confident at teaching it. So in my case, experience counted.
Okay. Chris. So how do we get the best out of students, and how do we get them engaged in class and prepared for exams? Now, we don't want students looking like this, as you can see here, bored, unmotivated, not engaged with the class. We want to welcome and encourage their participation in classes. We want them to enjoy the class while feeling reassured that they are being adequately prepared for their Cambridge English exams, if they are taking them, of course, and additionally prepared for life for using English in everyday circumstances. So we're going to look at a poll now. So here's a list we drew up earlier showing what we think is important in a team context. Now, we'd like to ask for your input here, as well as using the quick poll. Which of these do you think is the most important? Let's see which one of these measures is most important to you in your teaching context. Now, context was mentioned earlier. Do you think the most important is 1, age-appropriate topics, 2, an adequate range of vocabulary and grammar, 3, plenty of skills practice, 4, exam information strategies and tips, 6, using multimedia, including online games and videos, or 6, incorporating cross-curricular and cultural lessons. Again, which do you think is most important in your teaching context? I want you to choose numbers 1 to 6 in the poll now. Please. So see what's coming up.
So there's a bit of a age appropriateness and plenty of skills practice.
Mm-hmm. Okay, equally balanced, aren't they, at the moment? Not much at the moment for incorporating cross-curricular and cultural lessons at the moment. Yeah. There's definitely a race between 1 and 3. So that's age appropriate.
Skills practice is edging it.
It's edging
right
it
there.
At the moment. Between those two, and then after that, and quite a long way behind, is number 2, adequate range of vocabulary and grammar.
Mm-hmm.
That's all about that kind of, again, what we looked at before was that skills practice and trying to get
skills,
that balance between
age.
Exactly, making sure it's appropriate. We don't want them unmotivate or demotivate them, and we want to get that balance with skills.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, thank you for that. Very interesting. And to get that kind of balance between numbers 1 and number 3. So are there any other points you think are important to note here that we haven't mentioned yet? If you have a suggestion, we would really like to hear it. So write it in the chat box. It's important, okay, to note that we are working in a variety of places and contexts, so there are bound to be plenty of other concerns depending on your own teaching context. So again, we mentioned before about context. These are just 6 of the ideas that we've had. Again, we'd love to hear what different contexts that you've got. So in the chat box, some of your comments would be much appreciated. So we're coming up with Rob.
Voice opinions. Participation.
Participation's a good one, yes.
Specialised vocabulary.
Oh, that's an interesting one.
Testing.
Going back to that real English approach.
Appropriate topics.
Highly addictive. It's highly interactive activities, I think. And addictive activities would be good as well. Actual debating skills, yeah.
Somebody's asking if 1 and 6 can be combined. So that's age appropriateness and cross-curricular. Yes. So obviously there's a correlation between those
crossover.
Two if we're getting them right.
Absolutely.
Okay. Creativity.
Creativity's
I do
nice.
Like to see creativity.
Like life skills, creativity. That's something I'm particularly interested in, yeah.
Yeah, students' own career goals taken into consideration.
Lots
of good
really
good
interesting ideas here.
Thick and fast.
To modify our slide, I think. Definitely. Interacting with each other. A flipped classroom. I like the flipped classroom. Debating skills, again, I think something we're seeing much more of now. It's emerging in sort of different types of a modern 21st century class. So lots of, we can get stuck on this all day looking at these ideas coming through. They're fabulous. But on we go.
The time is pressing. So now we're going to take a look at how we might integrate exam practice into an English class so we can cater for those taking an exam, but also make the lesson equally relevant to those not interested in taking an exam. In a moment, I'm going to ask you to look at a typical exam task from Cambridge English Exam in the handout. Before you look at the example, I'd like you to consider these three questions. Just think about them for now. Firstly, which Cambridge English exam do you think this is from? Secondly, what is the topic? And finally, which skill or skills do you think are being practiced? Okay, so you have the three questions. Now turn over the handout, exam tasks, and look at task A. You shouldn't read it in detail. Just skim it for a few seconds, and then I'm going to return to the three questions. So just look for a moment. You don't need to write anything yet. Just think.
Already we've got comments coming through.
Okay. So now I'd like you to share your answers in the chat box for each question. We'll do each question again, one by one. So, what do you think for question one? Which Cambridge English exam is it from? Please type your answer into the chat box now. A lot of PET coming through, FCE.
It is, got some FCE as well.
Reading. Use of English. Okay, so we want the level of the exam, the Cambridge English exam.
So which one is it? Is it?
Okay, not the part of the exam, but which level?
So is it like key or ket, preliminary PET, or is the first?
Okay, so we're getting. Oh, we've got somebody saying for schools. Okay, so lots of. Some giving us the CFR level. All right.
We've got IQ, which I think is excellent. I'm not sure that's. Okay.
So, for those of you who put Cambridge English preliminary, you're right. This is part five of the reading paper, the multiple choice close. I'm sure many of you are very familiar with this exam type, test type, as it's not the only used in preliminary, but appears in Cambridge English Key and Cambridge English First, probably why we got those responses we did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So just to remind you, Cambridge English Key Reading and Writing Part 5 has only A, B and C to choose from and 8 questions. And Cambridge English First Reading and Use of English Part 1 has 4 options and 8 questions. So question 2, the topic. Please type your answers into the chat box now.
Right, so now it's topic, isn't it?
Topic we're looking at. So who's going to be the first one to arrive? A topic? A pause? Oh, somebody's got environment. Okay, endangered species.
Reese's got the orangutans. Animals.
Critical thinking from Simona. Skills.
I want to come back to what Simona said earlier about trendy resources as well. Well, that's for later.
Okay, animals.
Yeah, we're in the ballpark,
monkeys,
aren't we?
Orangutans.
Ecology. Something. Geography. Okay. Wild animals,
biology.
Yeah.
Okay, lots coming in thick and fast.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, as most of you suggested, the topic here covers, you know, wild animals, environment and animal welfare, as well as wildlife and its natural environment, in particular, rainforest. Not sure I saw rainforest there. And finally, the third question, which skills are being practiced? So type your answer into the chat box now.
So now on to skills.
Nah, somebody's got rainforest in there.
They've got rainforest, yes.
Don't know about the delay, do you? So. Reading.
Okay, so skills are coming through now.
Grammar, reading, vocab.
A lot of reading coming through. Use of English has been mentioned. Reading, and grammar. Yeah.
Okay, a lot of fast typing going on out there.
Absolutely. Super fast.
Okay, we can have a look at those later. A proper look at them. Okay, so as many have suggested there, the skill students are practicing is reading. So to summarise, This is a text looking at issues of endangered orangutans in Indonesia, giving background information and some suggestions as to how people can help. Today, we want to use this very typical exam test type and look at examples of how it might be integrated into an English lesson in a way that not only makes it more appealing and engaging for our teenage students, but also in a way that manages to help students prepare for this type of task. Finally, we want to show how we can start with one task type and skill area and then transfer it over to other skill areas, ensuring a much more balanced lesson in terms of skills and language. So let's have a closer look at what we mean here. What we want to do is have a think about how you might use this exam test type in your classroom. Which of the two following lesson sequences might you use to wrap around this task type? So, you can also find these lesson sequences on the handout in exam task in task B. So read through each sequence and decide which one you prefer, A or B. Vote now using your polling buttons. Okay. So what are we seeing anything there? Do I need to repeat the question, do you think? Are
we getting some answers? We're getting too low. We get a lot of people commenting in the chat box, but we're setting this up as a poll. So have a look.
Okay.
The poll's working out. So we've got, massive.
So it's on the handout, sequence A or sequence B. Which do you prefer?
And we're seeing a fairly consistent 80 to 20 in favour of sequence A.
Yeah.
It's currently 83 to 17. So, yeah, it's...
Some people are still writing them in the chat box, though. So if we could have your answers on the poll, then we'll have everybody's answers together.
Capturing everything together, that way it's much better.
Yeah.
So it seems to have levelled off now.
The poll's gone quiet.
Poll's gone very quiet. It's levelled off at sort of 80-20, really.
Okay.
In favour of sequence A.
Moving a little bit again.
Okay.
Okay, I don't think it's going to move
very clear,
massively
though, I think.
Now.
You've got a very clear answer to that one, haven't you?
My statistical training. So let's think about the advantages of lesson sequence A. Firstly, it leads gently into the task with a discussion activity, which can be a good way of personalising the topic and includes a mix of skills, speaking, listening and reading. It also activates the students' experience of the topic and related vocabulary they're familiar with and helps them prepare mentally for the topic. As the vocabulary is more familiar when they approach the task, the students will probably be more interested and curious. And finally, this whole sequence encourages students to apply more of a thinking process prior to any reading. Lesson sequence B also has some advantages. Jumping straight into the exam task is more reminiscent of the actual exam, so could be good preparation for students who are about to take the exam, as they are training themselves in what strategies to apply in an exam situation. However, it could be argued that this would mean they are simply testing themselves rather than actually preparing themselves. It also includes other skills, vocabulary development, speaking and listening, but as a follow-up to the exam task. In summary, I suggest that sequence B would demand quite a bit of extra help and support as it stands, whereas A is more user-friendly from the offset. So, please turn to task C on the handout and see where this came from.
Okay, so this is level 5 of our 7-level Cambridge exam, English exams for schools course for teenagers and younger students. It's called Prepare. You can see that the opening 2 pages of this unit reflect lesson sequence A in the previous slide. So the lesson begins with a small discussion around the topic, animals and us. Then some topic vocabulary is introduced with lots of visual support for this age group. They're given plenty of opportunity to practice the vocabulary in the discussion, and then students practice it further through a short listening task before then moving to the exam reading task itself. So let's think about another question. What happens in this lesson immediately after the exam practice task? So there are three prompt questions followed by a speaking task designed to get students to express their own ideas and opinions on the text. In other words, we finish the lesson by asking our class to give a personalised response. In personalising the topic in this way, we hope to capture the students' interests and imagination while also focusing them on important moral values. So, we've looked at some ideas for leading into the text and the exam task. Now let's think about how we might further exploit this exam question. The easiest way to do this is to consider a class you teach and think about what would interest and help your students after they have done the task. Could they transfer to another skill, for example, writing? Probably, yeah. Could they do more speaking? Yes. Can we exploit the text and vocabulary and grammar? Definitely. So remember, we said earlier that we want to create a balance of exam preparation and general English skills. We want to try to find ways of integrating exam tasks into general English lessons that appeal to teens and balance both the skills practice and the language input the students need, not just in exams, but in life. So to briefly recap then, in the previous section, we saw what concerns might be met in class with the balancing of certain aspects over others. Then we looked at what we ideally need to help prepare teenage students for not only exams, but also English in life. And we have now just seen how we might immediately lead into and animate a practice sequence for a reading task. So let's look at that text again now. Okay, so here it is again. We've seen what came before this in our lesson, but what about the things we could do to follow up this text? Well, after we've checked comprehension, it's very common to go back to a text and exploit it in terms of grammar. So take a look at the text now. What do you think the main grammar focus of a follow-up lesson might be? Write your suggestions in the chat box now. So what I'm asking you to do here is look at this text and ask you, what do you think the main grammar focus of a follow-up lesson might be? So remember, put your suggestions in the chat box now. And let's see what's coming through.
Conditional sentences.
Conditional, off the okay. Conditionals, yeah. If clauses, yeah. Conditionals.
Passives coming in there.
Yeah, it's pretty clear, isn't it? Conditionals.
There's conditional. We're narrowing it down.
Very becoming more specific. That's good. So yes, it's clear. As many of you have suggested, there are several examples of conditional sentences, and this would be a good grammar point to follow up with.
So as well as providing engaging, age-appropriate texts on topics that teenagers are interested in, it's also important when teaching teens in an exam class to make sure that the texts and topics cover the vocabulary and themes required by the Cambridge English for Schools exams. These can then be used as a springboard for grammar, vocabulary and skills practice. Take a look at the last page of the handout. In this section of the four-page unit of Prepare, you can see how students are directed back to the context of the text to begin the grammar cycle of the lesson. And not only that, but we then transfer to other skill areas. In this example, we can see the required grammar and extra vocabulary practice that's in every unit, but also more listening and speaking, plus a closer look at Cambridge English Preliminary Speaking Part 3. In other units, we would see other mixes of skills practice and exam practice, but always along the same lines of integrating skills and practice with language and motivating topics, and integrating exam practice and general English development. It's not only important that the topics cater for students taking an exam, but also that they engage learners. For example, this text from Cambridge English Key, from Prepare, the course book, describes and discusses superstitions. The text, also from Prepare Level 3, which is for Cambridge English Key, looks at music festivals. And this one, from Prepare Level 5, which is for Cambridge English Preliminary, broadens horizons with a look at classrooms around the world.
So it is useful to expose students to exam-type tasks well in advance of the exam itself. This reduces fear and turns the exam into an exercise in simply showing what the students know. With Prepare, we begin introducing exam-style tasks the year before the exam is taken. So there are two books for each exam, designed to be used over 2 years. In the first year of each cycle, students are not even aware of exam task practice. This example shows how, in the entry-level books, that is levels 2, 4 and 6, exam content and help is highlighted in the teacher's book, but it's not obvious in the student's book. Students are gradually exposed to exam requirements and question types, but without the stress and fear. At exam exit levels, that is levels 3, 5 and 7 of Prepare, the exam tasks become slightly more explicit in the student's book. The teacher may point out the coloured boxes to students if they wish, and these coloured boxes represent exam tasks. This is the examples we already looked at, which is from level 5, the Cambridge English preliminary exit level.
In the next section, we want to tell you about the research and methodology underpinning our exam preparation course, Prepare. Here's a question for you to consider. How do we ensure students are learning the appropriate range of English to their exam level and that the language is current and relevant? Please write your ideas to answer the question in the chat box now. I'll repeat the question. How do we ensure students are learning the appropriate range of English for their exam level and that the language is current and relevant? So answers in the chat box now. What do we say?
Instant reactions here. We've got intuitions coming through. An honest answer about not sure. Graded material. I think that's very good, using graded material. By using Cambridge textbooks. Thank you. Excellent answer. By asking them to use it both in writing and speaking, good. Gosh, it's coming through so quickly, isn't it? Really good responses here. It's just trying to do justice to it, really.
But I'm picking up on a few things which are coming next. I don't want to read them out because I'm obviously tuned in on that. There's lots of answers coming in now. Okay. Okay, good. So, as many of you commented, intuition counts, usually based on teaching or examining experience. Maybe you keep up to date with current language through television, films, and the internet. I saw some people had put videos down on there. But in the world where English is becoming increasingly more important, and what's more, an actual life skill for many, we want to guarantee that relevant English is being delivered to our learners at the right time. Cambridge University Press and Cambridge English Language Assessment have combined forces to ensure we have the most up-to-date information, not only on how expert users of English use English, but also on the English which exam candidates use and need at each exam level. Our unique Cambridge Learner Corpus, somebody referenced it in there, I did see the answer come up, is a collection of data driven from real Cambridge exam scripts and analysed to give us deeper insights to the types of help we can give different learners at different stages of learning. It is a collection of several hundred thousand examination scripts written by learners from all over the world that is added to every year. Combined with solid evidence of use in many other sources related to general English, such as examination vocabulary lists and classroom material, the Cambridge Learner Corpus confirms what learners can and cannot do at each level. Let's have a quick look at what this means in our 7-level course, Prepare.
Okay. So these are some common mistakes extracted from real Cambridge English exams and fed back into our materials via the Cambridge Learner Corpus as a guide for students at each level. In the series Prepare, we have added these yellow boxes called Corpus Challenge to raise learners' awareness of language points. Here in this example, common errors. As you can see, these examples focus on basic word order with adverbs of frequency and the formation of the present tense. I'm sure I don't need to tell you that in the answer here in this case is B, in both cases. Which level of exam, though, do you think this is from? Write in a chat box which Cambridge English exams you think this is. Do you think it's Cambridge English Key, or Cambridge English Preliminary, or Cambridge English First? So I'll ask you that question again. I'm going to ask you where this comes from. Which level do you think it comes from? Do you think it's Cambridge English Key, Cambridge English Preliminary, or Cambridge English First? So put your answers, write your answers into the chat box, please. And it's coming straight through again. A very responsive audience we've got here.
Key.
And we've got the preliminary. Excellent. We've got the.
People are going for shorthand.
We've got the CFR as well. And again, the CFR levels, right, which is encouraging, extremely encouraging. It's a fascinating answer. So yes, it's clear,
thick
I think,
and fast, yeah.
Coming through thick and fast. So yes, I think the majority is clear. It's Cambridge English Key. So this is from the second book in our Prepare series after the introductory book, Level 1. Book 2 is the entry level for Cambridge English Key. And what about these two examples of errors from the Cambridge Learners Corpus? These both focus on passive structures where the part of the verb to be is missing. Which exam level do you think these are from? Write your answers in the chat box now. So again, what level do you think this is from? We got through coming here. We've got a wider range of exams coming through now. Mm-hmm. Interesting. It's interesting between that kind of... A lot of kind of A2, A1 in the CFR level. So yeah, this is from the Cambridge English Preliminary entry level book, Prepare Level 4. As I said before, our database is analysed to make sure that the right information goes into the course books depending on the kind of language that is produced by learners taking exams at different levels. This is to ensure that the books are preparing students with the kind of language they will meet in the Cambridge English exams.
Here's another way we guarantee real English. The English vocabulary profile is part of the English profile programme, a long-term research programme sponsored by the Council of Europe, and is based on extensive research using Cambridge Learner Corpus and Cambridge English Corpus, a multi-billion word corpus of spoken and written current English covering British, American and other varieties of English. Let me show you an example of how this is used in Prepare from the lesson we looked at earlier in this section. The blue boxes in Prepare units focus on aspects of English profile, EP, and show students how language is being used in different ways at different levels of the Common European Framework of Reference for Languages, so the CFR, in order to meet the goals of each level. Can you guess which words are being focused on here? Two distinct meanings of the words are illustrated in these three examples. Write the word in the chat box now. Okay, so if you look on the screen at the example, which are the words that are blanked out? Which are we focusing on there? Do we have any answers? Besides
is coming through. We get the type of word as well. We've got nouns, but we're looking for the actual word.
We're looking for the yes, as Chris just said.
We've got, I suppose, put animals, which is interesting.
Okay. So what is behind the, what is in the blank? What do we need in the blank to...
It's like a gap fill, isn't it?
Yeah, in the gap fill. I'm saying a few more besides. Okay.
I think animals, I'm trying to think, would that work for all three? There animals are other kinds of tuna, animals, the blue... I think it would work for the second one.
Okay. I definitely saw a few people put besides. So as you said, it is besides. And just to remind you, here's where it came from in the unit we looked at earlier. Useful words and phrases such as besides can carry different meanings and are explored throughout the levels of Prepare to keep students up to date with the current language usage and to give them some idea of the range and appropriacy of language required at their exam level.
Okay. So in this final section, we want to share some of the insights we've already had from users of Prepare. Here are some examples of comments we've received from teachers. Firstly, one teacher said, the videos using real student interviews really cover the topics well. For example, Michael interviewing different secondary students about luck. This is from Prepare Level 4, Unit 16. And now we'll play you this short video so you can get a feel for the kind of videos that are included in the Prepare series.
This film is about luck. Yesterday, I went on a trip to San Francisco. It was my lucky day. What do you understand by luck?
I think it's when something good happens to you by chance.
I believe luck is when my favourite football team wins.
For me, it's when a good question on an exam comes up and I revise for it.
What things do you think are lucky or unlucky?
Some people think that black cats are unlucky, but I used to have one as a pet.
Some people believe that walking under a ladder is unlucky, but I don't believe that.
I think lucky is when you're walking and you find a lucky penny and it means you have a good day.
Do you know anyone who's lucky?
My granddad is very lucky because he wins at bingo.
Yes, my mum always seems to win Christmas hampers on the raffle.
Well, I was recently chosen to be head boy, so I think that's pretty lucky.
Fair enough. Congratulations.
Okay, it'd be interesting to hear what you think about the video, but I think it's important to point out here that the students in that video were real students. So we're seeing authentic English being demonstrated by students. I think it's something, something that many of our teachers ask us for. We've tried to introduce that into Prepare. And another teacher commented that the seven levels worked really well as they allow teachers to select the appropriate level that fits their class. And we also had feedback that there are two books per Cambridge exam level, an entry book and an exit book. And this works really well in school systems. And teachers tell us that their students love the topics, which they find motivating and age appropriate. So there we have it. I feel that we have evidence that the approach we have taken with Prepare really does work for teachers and learners in a way that they both can enjoy.
So we hope you've enjoyed today's webinar and on engaging and motivating teens towards exam success. Just to sum up then, we looked first at examining the various concerns we may have when we're teaching teens. And then we looked a bit more detail at the needs of the majority of teenagers when preparing for Cambridge English exams, or teenagers that are simply learning English generally, and how to make the balance work in practice. Next, we looked at an example of Cambridge English exam test types and showed how we might construct a sequence of lesson stages around this, integrating skills, language practice, and of course, exam preparation. We used examples from Cambridge English for Schools Prepare series to illustrate all of this. Finally, we showed how research underpins everything we publish and shared some of the feedback we've already gathered from teachers using Prepare. We'll now pass you back to Nancy, who'll talk to you about some of the other resources we offer teachers. Then we will answer any questions you have about today's webinar. Please type in any questions you have and we'll do our best to answer a selection of them.
Absolutely.
Okay, thanks, Nancy. So we're looking at these questions. I've picked up one from Naira. I hope I've said that correctly after my years of living in Spain. And she's asking how to deal with Spanish learners and the difficulties in writing.
Good question.
I think this tunes into Prepare. But also in English teaching generally, and it's not just specific to Spain. So I think that's a nice one to start with. I think the way that when I was teaching, I always approached this, and we definitely, as I say, in Prepare and our other courses, we approach it this way: is process writing is how to approach writing. Somebody once said to me, a few years into my teaching career, having been through university, having been through doing all my exams as a youngster, that when you write for somebody to read it. So always we need to consider the reader. But it's process writing to arrive at that product. It's the ideas generation. It's how we produce the format of that writing and then lead through to the writing. We don't sit down with a blank piece of paper and think that we can write straight away. It's a process that keeps coming back, and you need to edit and you need to check and you need to question. It's a huge skill to learn over a period of time. And that's why any good course book should encompass process writing from beginning to end. The skill of writing, not just the produced text at the end. How do you get to that point? Okay, and as I say, Prepare does that, our other courses do that, and any good course book should do that. Chris, have you seen anything?
I've got one here from Jay, which is an interesting one. It talks about speaking exercises, which we've mentioned, and asks, couldn't the teachers be given more options for speaking tasks or a topic so that students and or the learners can pick up more something more relevant to them? It is something that we get asked a lot. You know, when we go into classrooms, we talk to teachers, we talk to learners, and finding things and finding opportunities to talk around a subject that's interesting to them. Again, we're looking at options, you know, we'll be doing with our new additions or various different courses that we're looking at, and trying to encourage students to talk to each other outside the classroom, maybe between different schools. We know that Cambridge English Language Assessment does a pen friend opportunities where students can talk outside the classroom, as I said, with students from different countries in English. And I think it's an interesting one. I think we're looking at developing more material for teachers, but also giving the teachers tools to develop topics and ideas and classroom activities that they can then personalise for their students. I think that's really important. We can give only so much, but I think to really engage with students, teachers really need to have something that will work with their students. And I think it's an opportunity to create, like I said, a set of tools, a toolbox, which allows them to do that. I think that's a really interesting question, something that we should be much more aware of, or which we are aware of, becoming much more as part of our future development of courses. So many good questions. We are capturing all these questions, I hope, because we've got really interesting.
I've tuned into another one, I think might be from Spain, from somebody called Monica, asking about using how do I deal with test preparation in a bilingual dual project. It's a wide-ranging question, but I'm focusing in on this because Prepare, if you're in the Madrid area and you know about the bilingual project in Madrid, Prepare is being used very successfully in many schools there. And because of the two-year preparation cycle, that's why we find that it's been very successful in that situation. So maybe Monica, if you are in the Madrid area, I'm guessing, but perhaps you could speak to some colleagues who are using it.
I think we're running, I'm not sure we're coming to the end of our time here, sadly, and there's so many good questions here. There's one that was very specific, asking whether there are facilities in place for visually impaired students to take the first certificate, and I can't answer that right now, but I think that's an interesting question. I think we'll certainly look into that, and if you'd like to send your email address or something into this, we'll certainly get back to you. I think that was a very interesting question.
And just on a bit more of a specific question as well, again, where somebody's asked the difference between complete, which is one of exam preparation titles, and prepare, where we find a difference between those. Well, complete is by exam. So you find it for Cambridge English Key or preliminary or first. And there are the for schools varieties as well, and it's a designated idea of a 1 year course, shall we say, in each book. Some people split that book over 2 years, but generally that's the way it's designed around people training for the exam. And it's a straight exam training book. Prepare, we split the years into two, so there's two levels of prepare for each book of complete, shall we say. And we gradually build students' confidence around the task types and the type of English and the level of English in the first level without knowing specifically that it's an exam book. And then in the second, the odd number, 3, 5, and 7, we dedicate more focus and there's more, it's more apparent on the page that they're actually training towards the exam. And what we call the exam journey, there's less exam specifics in book in the even numbers 2, 4, and 6, and more specific in 3, 5, and 7. Okay, so key, preliminary, and first.
I've got last question. I think this is a really interesting one, and I'm going to probably mispronounce your name. I do apologise. I've got Yudmila ask, is it possible to prepare such webinars for students? I think it's a great idea. Obviously, the vast majority of the people here today with us are teachers, and it's clear, you know, experienced teachers. Teachers are very passionate about what they do. It's obvious from the questions and the comments that have come through. But I think delivering a webinar to students and encouraging students to participate is a wonderful opportunity for them to use English, an opportunity for us to really listen to what they want in the classroom. I think that's an excellent idea. Certainly be looking into whether that's possible. So thank you. And again, apologies for more than likely mispronouncing your name.
Okay.
Again, I'm not sure where we are with time. Possibly one more question, do you think?
Well, yes, but I'm back with the same person. Naira has a question to deal with lack of imagination or doing collaborative tasks. And I mean, from my experience, depending on the dynamics in the classroom, of course, and that's something that takes a long time to create and get right, and it's the have to versus the want to's, difficult in class. But it's preparation time. It's what we touched on in the webinar, really. It's that students are engaged and unlock their own understanding of the topic area before asking them to do specific work around that topic area. So it's bringing their own world experience to the task, rather than it being just imposed and open the book and go for it. And it was that A-B class type that we talked about. Mm. The more that you can get a student or your class to buy in to their knowledge of what you want them to look at, the more they will be able to produce. Mm. Okay. I hope that helps.
Absolutely. As again, a lot of questions around this idea of authenticity. Totally agree with Erkin saying authentic materials are so useful for reading, definitely, because it's something that's real and it automatically increases that sense of involvement, engagement, motivation from students. And of course, a lot of our students, certainly secondary school students, are very active on social media, very active on sort of their YouTube and the rest, and sort of basically absorbing, sucking in all this vocabulary as well. So the more authenticity we can use, but it's tricky how to moderate that authenticity in the classroom. I could look at these questions all day. Yeah. Fascinating, aren't they? Absolutely fascinating.
Okay. I think we're
out of time.
We're out of time. We've got one last one from Bill saying, are past paper packs still available for CEP? That. Many years ago, we did past papers. We no longer do past papers. We do authentic practice tests, which are practice tests which come out of the exam writing process. We ask for them at the beginning of the exam writing process, and they come from the same teams. They go through the same research and validation that we call it, and the same pre-testing as the actual exam items. So we don't do past papers anymore, but we do authentic practice tests.
Authentic as it gets. It can't be more authentic.
No,
110% authentic. Right, well, thank you very much. That was an absolute pleasure.
Yep.
Really enjoyed that.
I hope it was useful. Thank you.
Right. The next webinar coming up is Understanding Grammar and Vocabulary Assessment, What Every Teacher Should Know. This takes place on March the 20th and March the 22nd. So all it says from myself and Rob is to say thank you and goodbye.
Okay, goodbye. Thank you.